Okay, so in our last lectures, we have already started with general defenses in law of tort, and we have taken up quite a good number of defenses that are available to the defendant in order to protect himself or herself against any wrong which is deemed to be committed by him, or you can say against the accused. So all the defenses that we have already covered were voluntary non-fit interior, plaintiff himself a wrongdoer. We have also done inevitable accident, misvager. We have done even the force majeure. So we were through with a good number of defenses that are available, and we were left with two. That is, one is the private defense, the defense of private defense, and the last one is that we are going to do is the defense of necessity. So this is what we have already done in the last class. So now today we'll be starting with the defense of private defense. So when we talk about the defense of private defense, we need to understand that when we are talking about private defense, we say that every person has this right to defend his property or his body or the third person. So when we talk about the right to private defense, it is talking about the fact that every person has a right to protect his or her property, his or her body, and or the body or property of a third person. It also includes protecting the property or person of another person if it belongs to a third person. And he can use any necessary force which is required to avoid that danger that is likely to cause harm to his property or his body, right? So private defense is basically talking about the situation where a person is applying necessary force. Necessary means proportional force, force that is required, force that is considered to be reasonable. So when we talk about private defense or self-defense, we are saying that these are one of the good defenses that is available under the law of tort. And you will come across the term private defense, or you can say self-defense, when you will be doing criminal law as well. Because even under criminal law, we have this concept of private defense where parties are given, where defendant is given this opportunity when we are talking, defendants are given this, that the particular act that has been committed by them is because in the spur of a moment, and this is mainly to protect his or her property or a bodily injury. So what is this right doing? This right is entitling a person to go to any extent to protect one's life, property. That are available under the law of tort. Private defense is the most common. Am I audible right now? Because I think there is.
Ma'am, your voice is breaking.
My voice breaking?
Yes.
Is my am I clear now? Was my voice breaking? Was there a disturbance in between?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, your audio is not there again.
My voice was breaking in between.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, going, ma'am.
Okay, so now is it clear? So I was saying that when we are talking about right to defense, we say that it's a defense. It's that part which is also available under the criminal law. Even a defendant can say that a particular act has been committed in order to protect himself or his property or the person or property of the third person. So when we talk about law of tort, we say that it's a very good defense under law of tort, and it's the most common defense that is available. So when a defendant tries to protect, what it is saying, when a defendant tries to protect his or her body, property, or the person of another property, right, or harm to another person by using the reasonable form of force, or you can say proportionate force, which is required to avoid the danger, and what is said to be the necessary force, is being used in order to avoid any danger, then we say that the private defense is available and it is said to be considered as defense of private defense or self defense. But so what is it? What we are saying, it is a human instinct to repel force by force. That is, there is some force which is used against you, and you are trying to repel that force by using your own force. Okay, and this natural instinct says that how you will act in a given situation. It's an automatic. It's action reaction that is there for every action. So, in natural instinct means if there is a particular situation in front of you, and how you have acted. So, this is something which is justified not only by the judges, but also has been given statutory recognition. So, what I am saying here is that it is something which is also under criminal law. Statutory recognition, we say that it is something which is also recognized by law in the written form. So, what it is saying, that every person, therefore, has a right to defend his own property, person, or possession against an unlawful harm. But in defending the force that is used, it must be in proportion to the apparent urgency of the situation. It means what is required in a given situation. So what force you are using, it should be equivalent, it should be proportionate to the danger which is likely to be there. So what is the, and the question when we're talking about this, we say that where you can apply your private defense, I've already told you that this is for the defense of person, your own or other, and defense of property. But when you can apply this defense, you can apply this defense only when there is some imminent danger, there is some you know that the danger is going to harm you, and you cannot skip it except acting in a particular manner. So there are a few grounds that you need to take into consideration before taking the defense of private defense. That is, like, there was an imminent and immediate danger. I'll explain it to you what it means. The force employed was not out of proportion. Through examples, it will become clear to you that what do we understand by imminent danger? What do we mean by whether an act is out of proportion or not? When we say that the force employed is only for the purpose of defense and not for any other purpose, the force should not be used by way of retaliation after the danger is over. So once the danger is over, you cannot say that I'm applying particular force in order to protect myself. We'll see the examples relating to all this, and it will become clear to you as to what it is. So basically, you can say that there are two basic essentials. One is that there is a reasonable force and there is an imminent danger for which you are using your reasonable force. So the question comes that as to what do you understand by reasonable force. So when we are talking about reasonable force, which is used in private defense, we say that it must be reasonable, right? And what is reasonable force? It means a force which is used to repel, to avoid the attack, and which is necessary to protect one's own bodily harm, any damage to property or bodily harm or damage to property of a third person. So this force that we are using, it should be proportional, as I've already said, that it should be equivalent to the, you have to act as per the nature of the circumstances, as what existing. And what that situation expects from you, what should be your reaction in a particular situation. So proportional means defendant should apply a reasonable force. So these are correlated, that reasonable force will be considered to be reasonable only when it is proportional to the danger, right? What do you mean by proportional? That it should not, what is required? So it should not of what is required in a given situation. And moreover, under this, if there is a malice and one is not naturally reacting to the attack on oneself, but such a reaction is pre-planned, then will you say that the reasonable force is there? No. Then in such cases, it is deemed that the force that is used is unreasonable, and then the defense will not react. So there should not be any bad intention. There should not be any pre-planning. when you are applying this defense of private defense or taking this defense of private defense, you need to be clear. You need to prove, you have to be very clear with this. Thus, what force is necessary or when reasonable force is required, it all these things depends on circumstances of each case, circumstances of and situations as exist in different situations. Like, for example, if for where we can say that the reasonable force has been used. Like, for example, if for example, keeping dogs, right? You are keeping dogs where you also state this, that beware of dogs. So what is it? You are keeping dogs to protect your own property, right? Like if a thief breaks into the defendant's personal property and tries to injure the defendant by beating him with a rod, then the defendant should tackle the thief using proportional force, right? What, how, to what extent that thief is using, how, in, to what extent that person is armed, in what manner that person is using the force, in the same way, the same proportion should be your force, right? If he is using a shotgun, then he can fire it on thief leg instead of chest or forehead, right? If you say that if there is a thief that enters your premises and you are having your gun with a licensed gun, then instead of you can, what will be required is that there should, you have to create a fear that if you will not stop your act, I'm going to act in a particular manner. So you can shot in the leg instead of giving a shot to the head or chest, that can cause death. So what is required is what depends on the situation. But let's say the thief is also carrying some arms, some gun, and there is probability that the thief can hit you before you can hit. So you can use the force to such an extent that can kill the thief. Is it clear? So what we are saying, we are talking about here is that you can strike. If a person strikes me, I cannot be justified to use a sword. So this strike that that a person is using against me, the force that a person is using against me, I need to see that what is the level of force that has been used against me, and to what manner I have to act to that action that has been done. What should be my reaction? So it depends on that circumstances. Is it clear? So another example, like for example, you are fixing pieces of glass on your wall, right? Now, this is another thing that you must have seen, that many people put spikes or glasses, okay? Or you can say that there is some fence, pointed fence that is placed, and the purpose is only to avoid any kind of harm to their property, right? So this is also what is considered to be reasonable. Clear? But let's say you are putting barbed wire or spring gun, then it is something that goes out of proportion. So what it is saying, reasonable force, it says that the force that you are using should be defensive and it should not be offensive in nature. You have to use it for your defense. Is it clear? So this is why this correlates with the another element, which is imminent danger. Now, when we talk about imminent danger, we are saying what we talk about here is that the use of force is justified under self-defense only when there is imminent danger or threat to the safety of a person or property. That is, when we are saying that the danger is so much that you have no other way out except to act in a particular manner. So what it is saying? It is saying that the danger is imminent, where there is no time to report, okay, to report instantly to the nearest authority, or the defendant is not able to contact that specific authority, then he can start the defense of private defense. The act was such that it hasn't given you much time to decide that how you have to act, and you acted in a particular manner, right? The danger is such that it hasn't given you any time to think, right? Like, for example, if you see that there are few cases that we need to understand in order to understand the situation, whether the danger is imminent or not. Like for instance, in the second and third, if you compare the second example and the third one, the second one states that where the dog was attacking the herd of sheep, and therefore the owner who was there, in order to protect his sheep, he killed the dog. So this act of defendant was justified. Why? Because there was imminent danger. The dog was pounding on the sheep, attacking the sheep. And sheep are also animal and innocent animal. It could have been possible that the dog would have killed any of the sheep, and it was becoming difficult to handle the dog, right? Whereas in this third example, if you see, when the dog was running in order to bite the defendant gator, then what happened? Defendant picked up the gun, and dog, looking at this, started running away. But despite this, what happened? The defendant shot dead the dog when the dog was running away. So what is this case? This second example is showing that the danger was going away from you. There was no need of you to act in this particular manner wherein you have killed the dog. Okay, the danger was withdrawing himself or herself from the scene. Act from that particular act that was expected to happen. So in this third one, the defendant was held liable. In the second one, the defendant was not held liable. Now, in the first one where the plaintiff went up ladder, in this also the defendant was held liable. Why? Because court said that where you are avoiding a person to enter your premises and the person has placed a ladder, you could have given the warning instead of throwing him off the ladder, and that would have caused harm to him. You would have also told him that you cannot trespass my property, right? So you need to understand that what is the situation, what are the circumstances under which you are applying a particular force. So if the force is such which is required in order to avoid the danger, it is justified. Well, but in case where the danger is withdrawing itself from the scene of action, and still you acted in a particular manner, it is not justifiable. Clear? So there are many, many examples that we will find from our day-to-day life also, where it has been seen that whether a particular act will be justified or not, whether it will fall within the ambit of private defense or not. And it is a question that is decided by the court after taking into the circumstances, situations that existed. And yes, the burden lies on the person claiming the defense of private defense. Clear? So if I am claiming that I acted in a particular manner and I should be given the defense of private defense, then the burden will be on me to prove the same, that why I acted in a particular manner. Next is that is available is the defense of necessity. And defense done under the necessity. Right? You are applying the defense of necessity in order to avoid any greater harm. Or if the harm is done intentionally, then also there is no liability. So why? We'll just look into it, what it is talking about. So what it is saying, an act causing damage, if done under the necessity to prevent a greater evil, is not actionable if the harm was caused intentionally, right? Now, in certain circumstances, intentional injury to a person or property may be caused. And okay, fine. Am I clear now? From where should I start? Should I start the necessity again?
Yes, ma'am, please.
Okay. So the last part that is there for the defense of necessity is the defense of necessity. And the defense of necessity says that an act causing damage, an act causing damage, if done under the necessity to prevent a greater evil, which is in that case, if there is any damages, they are not actionable. So defense of necessity says that an act that causes damages and that damages are caused under the act of necessity to prevent any greater harm or evil, then the damages cannot be claimed. But this is a very questionable aspect, because in certain circumstances, damages are given by the court, right? but in, herein the damages that are caused, and if, even if there has been it has been intentional, that is what is not taken into consideration by the court. Like, let's say, for example, where when to in order to avoid ship from sinking, it became very necessary for the captain to lighten the load from the ship, and therefore he started throwing away the goods in order to save passengers and crew members. So it was considered to be the act of necessity. Another is, like, for example, if there is pulling down house in order to prevent the spread of fire is also considered to be the act of necessity, right? It is intentional. You can see this, right, in both the examples. Intentional, where the things have been overboard by the captain in order to, but what is it? The intention is to save the people on the ship, right? The intention is not to cause any damage to the party, but the intention is bona fide intention, not manner fide intention. The intention is there knowingly the person is doing a particular act, but the knowledge that a particular act can cause damages is something which is not taken into consideration by the court under the defense of necessity. Why? Because that particular intentional act is done in order to prevent some other greater harm that can happen to the parties or people or property, right? And in the second example also, where you're pulling down the house, why? You know that you are pulling down the house, you know that you're causing injury to the another, damages to the another person, but why? It, to avoid the further injuries, to avoid further harm, right? Like, for example, even if you're saving a drowning person, and while saving that person, some injuries caused to that person. Is it clear? So what is it? It is saying that necessity is that defense that allows you to act intentionally. But that intention should be bona fide. I'll wait for 2 minutes. I don't know why there is a this disturbance. Okay, so I hope this is clear. The what is it? The defense of necessity. So what is it based on? It is based on the maxim, Salus Populi Supreme Lexis, which means the welfare of people is the supreme. So if you're acting in a particular manner where you are acting for welfare of people, and in acting in that particular manner, you're causing damages also, your act is justified. Is it clear? This is what the defense of necessity is. So what we are saying in this, we say that there are a few cases also. First, let us take these cases that are there. Okay, this is to prevent a greater ill. This example I have already given you, right? So when we are talking about defense of necessity, it is very important to understand that why you are doing it, like forcibly feeding a hunger strike labor, defendant entering plaintiff fire to land to extinguish the fire, right? So what this is what trespassing, right? After age death, a sister-in-law removed the jewelry items and kept them in another room. Robbery happened. She was held liable as interference was not required. So there are also, this example is stating that, like, for example, wherever there is no need to act in a particular manner and still you acted. Like, for example, if there is a fire that broke out, and let's say you enter the property of the another person, despite this fact that the fire extinguisher, the firemen are there to extinguish the fire, right? Firemen, despite this fact that firemen were there to take care of the fire, you entered the premises. So that act was not required on you. So what is it? It's a situation where you're guilty of trespass. So similarly, the last example says, these examples will help you making out difference, that the necessity should also be done when it is required. Actually, when it is required, when there is, it is necessary to act in a particular manner, not to just to in any kind of reasonable interference is what is allowed under the defense of necessity. Yes. So the other examples are also there where the court has taken up into consideration whether a particular defense of necessity can be taken up or not. And if you remember, we have also done a case of R versus Dudley. We did this case, R versus Dudley, wherein, R versus Dudley was another case that was done, if you remember, in the previous semester, wherein the defense of necessity was taken up by the other crew members, and they killed Mr. Parker, who was the weakest among them. And they took this plea that he was the weakest amongst us, and therefore he would have otherwise also died. So we have killed him in order to survive. So court rejected this contention. We know that the court rejected this contention. So it is always that the defense of necessity is taken up. So when we talk about defense of private necessity, it is very unusual consider this practical application, and it why? Because it privileges the actor. It privileges the actor, the person who is acting in the right, in the sense that the property owner has no right to cost, and it is required in the welfare of the people. Then such intrusions are required by the third person. And the owner cannot interfere in that, cannot obtain a tort remedy for such intrusion. But at the same time, the actor must pay the compensation, that is necessity, for the harm done to the property owner if it is not required, if the act on his part was not required. Right? So what this principle suggests is that in some instances, privileges to use defensive force is, and in other certain cases, the act of necessity is not justified. So we have seen this, that when we are talking about these defenses, we do have certain exceptions. These defenses depends upon certain circumstances of the case, and it is not always that these defenses will be. The defendant need to prove that a particular has been committed in a particular manner. Okay. So we are done for the day. I hope, I know there has been a lot of disturbance today. I don't know why. There is some problem. But we are done with the defenses that are available. We are done with these justifications, and then now next class we'll be starting with unit 2 as stated in your syllabus.